Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents From the Garden to the City, The Place of Technology in the Story of God, by John Dyer. Narrated by Mike Lenz. Publisher's note, in this audio edition, you will hear references to charts present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Forward. John Dyer has written a book that few could write. Trained both in information technology and in theology, and well-versed in media ecology, he is unusually qualified to raise questions about how we make tools and how tools make us, focusing especially on the more recent developments in electronic and image-based technologies. With his distinctive background, Dyer is able to ask and answer two questions of our tools and technologies. What do they do for us? And what do they do to us? Dyer's viewpoint is self-consciously Christian, without being reactionary, tech-savvy without being naive, and well-considered without being pedantic. At a moment in history when our tools are being developed at a rate faster than our capacity to evaluate their impact, we need reliable guides to help us understand them well, so that we can use them thoughtfully and intentionally. John Dyer is such a guide, and this insightful volume dodges none of the difficult questions, while retaining a balanced and judicious consideration of those areas that do not yet enjoy universal consensus. From the Garden to the City traces the history of technology and toolmaking and candidly acknowledges that both human wisdom and folly, both piety and impiety, both humility and pride, have contributed chapters to this complicated history. Neither technophobes nor technophiles will be entirely satisfied with either Dyer's judicious reasoning or his cautionary encouragements. Each will prefer total, apocalyptic warfare, and each will be uncomfortable with his sniper-like precision. I have looked for a volume like this since I began teaching an Introduction to Media Ecology class in the early 2000s, and I commend it to all who are interested in electronic and image-based technologies, and to all whose thinking, like mine, has been influenced by people such as Walter Lippmann, Jacques Ellul, Marshall McLuhan, Daniel Boorstin, Walter Ong, Neil Postman, Winifred Gallagher, Maggie Jackson, Marianne Wolfe, Mark Bauerlein, William Powers, and Nicholas Carr. For all those who desire to be wise and faithful followers of Christ, without returning to his moment in technological history, this will prove to be a valuable, if not cherished, guide. Dr. T. David Gordon, Professor of Religion and Greek, Grove City College, Grove City, PA. Preface to the second edition. One of the perils of writing about technology is that it becomes dated before the file syncs to the cloud. In the decades since the first edition of this book was published, our world has continued to accelerate technologically, with once futuristic technology becoming mainstream. Cryptocurrency, virtual reality, smart speakers, self-driving electric cars, and mainstream technology becoming commonplace. Phones, social media, video conferencing. Even with all this change, the core argument of the book, that theologically, technology is a good fit from God that plays a significant part in the biblical story, and that particularly, technology is never neutral, but has an embedded value system that transforms individuals and communities, is still true. And yet, these technological accelerations and cultural movements invite updated examples and new reflection. In the category of technology that has become commonplace, perhaps the most life-altering has been the way phones have come to saturate our lives. In 2010, we still called them smartphones, and they were only just transitioning from the toys of the tech elite into the ubiquitous, ever-present, always-on, glowing rectangles that permeate our lives. Our phones make incredible things possible, both good and bad, but they are significant not just because of what we can do with them, but because of how we have rearranged our lives around them. We wake up to their alarms, respond to their notifications, record our most insignificant moments with their cameras, and then scroll through their feeds as we fall asleep. Phones not only have reshaped our individual habits, but they have also made larger societal shifts possible, such as enabling developing countries to skip wired phone and internet connections altogether, empowering remix culture, where individuals collect and arrange values and beliefs to their tastes, and empowering companies like Uber to transform the transportation industry, and Spotify to disrupt the music industry. The ubiquity of phones, in turn, accelerated the use of social media, which was just emerging from college culture, Facebook, and Silicon Valley, Twitter, in the early 2010s. New platforms have come and gone. Remember Google+? And different demographic groups gravitate toward some platforms more than others. But social media is now a part of everything, from schools and churches to politics and medicine. As with phones, the list of good and bad uses of social media is endless, but underlying that are profound changes to society, including political elections that centered on the use and abuse of social media, the rise of misinformation campaigns that accelerated an erosion of trust in traditional societal structures, and heightened tensions around important issues of justice and human rights. The pandemic and lockdowns of 2020 and later only accelerated these technological changes, and people around the world embraced and adapted to digital technology literally overnight. The idea of online church was a mere footnote in the first edition of this book, but due to the pandemic, it became something nearly every religious person in the world had experienced, along with online school, remote work, and grocery delivery. It is difficult to imagine how things would have played out if the pandemic had taken place 20 years earlier, when the internet was still young and tools like live streaming and video conferencing were not yet widely available. Today, it is difficult to imagine life, relationships, and business without them. As we have experienced the accelerations of mainstream technology becoming commonplace, we have also become more aware of the technology that was just coming on the market in 2010. For example, Bitcoin was invented in 2009, but it took years for it and its crypto competitors to make their way into mainstream financial discussions. Virtual reality, VR, too, has been around for decades, but has recently gone from being an expensive experimental technology to something that costs less than a phone to try, and is now the focus of many companies, like Facebook's parent company, Meta. Talk of robots and artificial intelligence, AI, has also entered the mainstream, where AI can be loosely defined as anything we used to think only humans could do. This includes deepfake videos, self-driving cars, and medical diagnoses, and will expand to more in the years to come. As we talk to our smart speakers, ideas about the singularity, transhumanism, bioethics, and designer babies have also emerged from science fiction into podcast discussion points and everyday conversations. Each of these events and trends are worthy of deep engagement and thoughtful discussion, though I can't fully address them all in an update to this book. But I have attempted to bring the examples and references throughout this edition into conversation with these events, while continuing to argue both that technology is still a good part of our image-bearing creativity, and that, more than ever, we need godly wisdom, developed in community, to faithfully navigate this new world. I hope these updates will allow us to faithfully and soberly embrace technology as one of God's many good gifts. Introduction. One day, a guest speaker brought an interesting contraption to our church. As our pastor introduced him, he pulled an old reel-to-reel movie projector out of its case and began to set it up. Some of the audience seemed to wonder why he'd bring something so technologically backward, but I was mesmerized as he attached the reels and weaved the celluloid film through a half dozen channels and pulleys. After working with it for some time, he finally connected the film to the second reel, plugged it in, and flipped the switch. But then, click, 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 click. Nothing happened. Something was obviously wrong. As the clicking sound continued, the room started to grow a little tense. People shifted awkwardly in their seats, letting our guest know he was wasting their time. But not me. I wasn't bored at all, because I could see exactly what had gone wrong. So I got up from my chair and marched straight down the aisle of the church, past the guest speaker, and up to the ancient, malfunctioning device. Without saying a word, I began to undo his work and carefully rethread the film back through the correct channels. The audience watched with some surprise, apparently aware that I had never used this device before. Some shook their heads in disbelief, while others shot knowing grins at each other. I continued to work, slowly threading the film, then reattached it to the second reel. I checked the plug, flipped a few switches, and then pressed the power button. Whirr! It worked! Now, this story probably seems fairly ordinary. Tech people like me are always fixing things in churches. However, you might be interested to know that I have absolutely no memory of the events I've just described. The only reason I know it happened is that while I was growing up, whenever my mom met someone new, she liked to tell the story of how her 3-year-old son had fixed a film projector he had never seen before. And so began my love and fascination with all things technological, from mechanical projectors to radio-controlled cars and planes to computers and mobile devices. I was the kind of kid who asked for a chemistry set for Christmas so I could do experiments in the garage, and who saved up money for an electronics kit from Radio Shack so I could wire up an alarm for my bedroom. Of course, like most children of the 80s, I played countless hours of video games. But when I finally bought an Xbox, it was not so much because I wanted to play Xbox games, but because I wanted to solder in a mod chip and play around with homebrew software. Fast forward a few decades. As a young adult, I found that I loved doing two things. The first was teaching the Bible, which led me to attend seminary. The second was computer programming, which led me to work in the web development world. God graciously provided me a web design job at the seminary I was attending, allowing me to combine my love for God and His church with my love for technology. As exciting as it was to do technology work for a ministry, I soon found that working for a ministry does not always pay all the bills. So I took on a few side projects that allowed me to build tools for companies like Apple, Microsoft, Harley-Davidson, Anheuser-Busch, the U.S. Department of Defense, and Dallas's NPR affiliate. Throughout my years in seminary, I continued to study and work hard in both theological studies and programming. I spent as much time learning Greek and Hebrew as I did learning languages like PHP, C#, Swift, Python, HTML, and JavaScript. But in my final semester of seminary, a professor who was known for both his brilliance and his shocking, out-of-nowhere statements said something that changed everything for me. In the middle of a lecture, addressing a variety of current issues in society and culture, he looked straight at all of us and said, "One of the most dangerous things you can believe in this world is that technology is neutral." "Wait, what?" I thought. Surely he must have misspoken. After all, nothing could be more obvious than the fact that technology is neutral. All that matters is how we use it, right? As he kept talking, I started arguing with the professor in my head. I could not think of a single tool, device, or technology that was morally good or evil in and of itself. Yes, a tool like the nuclear bomb has been used to kill hundreds of thousands of people, but it is based on technology that can also be used to generate inexpensive electricity for millions of people. Sure, people can choose to abuse computers and the internet, using them for all kinds of illicit purposes, from identity theft to the distribution of pornography. But the reason I chose web development for an occupation was that I also knew the internet could be used for incredible good, too. Outside work hours, I built websites like BibleWebApp.com and BestCommentaries.com to help church leaders find good biblical resources. My entire goal was to use the latest and greatest technology for the good of Christ and His church. What could be so dangerous about that? I returned to class the next day, prepared to ask the professor about his statement. Armed with the best arguments I could muster about why technology was, in fact, neutral. However, when I arrived that day, the professor was not there. He had fallen ill and would not be able to return to class that semester. What was I to do? How could I be sure I was right? And what if the professor was right after all? What if there was some problem with technology I had never considered? Does the Bible actually say anything about technology? Can we say anything more profound or helpful about our technological world than simply, "Don't be evil"? Google's old corporate motto? So I headed straight for my computer and started scouring the internet for resources. Strangely, though, when I attempted to find specifically Christian reflections on technology, I found very little. A quick search for theology and technology turned up dozens of results on how to use technology. But beyond calls to redeem technology or use social media less often, I found very little about how technology fits into the biblical story. Just as I was about to give up in frustration, a dear friend who worked two floors up from my office gave me a book on Marshall McLuhan's thought, and another friend who lived halfway around the world gave me a book by Neil Postman, a student of McLuhan. I later found out that McLuhan and Postman founded an academic discipline called media ecology, which studies how technology operates within cultures and how it changes them over time. Media ecologists look at what happens when a technology enters a culture, the same way that a biologist examines what happens when a new animal species enters an ecological environment. Digging a bit more, I found a subdiscipline of philosophy called, obviously enough, philosophy of technology, which asks questions about the nature of technology and how it relates to what it means to be human. These questions include, does technology have an independent nature? And should humans be classified as tool-making animals? More recently, from the field of sociology, a new discipline of digital religion has emerged, which takes a more data-driven approach to understanding how media and technology affect religious behavior and practices. Scholars in this field put the theories of those above to the test and see how regular people understand God and faith in a technological world. Some of these writers made me worry about where technology has taken us and lament the damage we do to one another with it, while others made me appreciate human ingenuity and creativity all the more. As I began to reread the biblical story with technology in mind, I saw things I hadn't noticed before about how deeply God cares about the things we make and how we use them. God's original calling on humanity was to have dominion over all the earth, making things from what he had made, moving humanity, as the title of this book suggests, from the garden to the city, or more specifically, from the Garden of Eden, Genesis chapter 2, to the city from heaven, Hebrews chapter 11, verse 16, Revelation chapter 21. This book is my attempt to connect the story of Scripture with the world of both ancient and modern technology, so we can fulfill our role as God's image bearers in a digital age. The argument I will make in this book might seem counterintuitive. As we will hear in a following chapter, most people assume that technology is simply neutral, and that all that matters is how we use it. I plan to upend this notion with two key ideas. First, as we study the Scriptures, we will find that, theologically speaking, technology is a God-given good. And second, we will discover that, practically speaking, technology is never neutral. By saying technology is good, I don't mean that every use of technology is good, nor do I mean that every individual tool or device is good. What I mean is that God created humans to bear his image, and one aspect of this is our creative capacity, which includes making and using technology. It's true that any technology can be used for good or evil, but its fundamental nature is tied back to image-bearing humanity, which God has declared as good. So, if technology can be used for good or bad, doesn't that mean it's neutral? I will argue no. Technology is never neutral. Whenever we use tools, from shovels and books to phones and virtual reality, regardless of whether we use them for good or evil, the act of using them forms us physically, mentally, spiritually, and relationally. The problem with thinking of technology as neutral is that doing so often makes us miss all the other non-neutral ways its presence in our lives affects us. For example, if someone were to argue that online giving is neutral, that is, it can be directed to good organizations or bad ones, I might point out that the act of giving in an offering plate, which requires prior planning and often happens in front of people, is a very different experience of worship than setting up a recurring transaction. While the content in both forms of giving is the same, money, and both are good and God-honoring, there are non-neutral differences between the two that disciple us in distinct ways and alter how we relate to ourselves, our community, and even God. Our goal, then, is not simply to condemn technology as bad. Neither is it to naively embrace every new gadget. Nor is it to glibly assume that because we are using a tool for good ends, nothing else matters. Instead, we are to carefully examine each new tool, device, and service, noticing the goodness of God in giving us such powers, and yet asking ourselves not only how we can use it, but also how using it might transform us in the process. As I did with the film projector so many years ago, I will use this book to dismantle the concept of technology, examine it carefully, and then put it back together again. My goal is to retell the story of technology in a way that honors God and the reason He put us here on earth. Questions. What is your first memory of a new technology, one that wasn't around when you were born? What was different about it compared to what came before? How do you see your faith informing or being informed by the way you create and use technology? What resources, books, websites, podcasts, people, have been helpful to you in thinking about technology? 1. Perspective. Just down the street from my house, there is a little Indian market my family and I like to visit when we need to pick up a few items for dinner. On the short walk there, we'll pass the neighbors from Korea who own a liquor store, the retired Germans with the meticulously kept lawn, a Chinese real estate agent who named both his dog and his daughter after himself, a tall Bulgarian man and his wife who both work on the chips that power our phone's internet connection, the chief ice cream scientist from an Italian gelato company, an Egyptian friend who brings the most delicious treats from Eid al-Fitr, and an elderly black woman still displaced from Hurricane Katrina. Some of these neighbors live in expensive homes, send their kids to expensive private schools, and drive new luxury vehicles. Just a few blocks away, however, another set of neighbors can barely afford their low-income, government-subsidized housing. They send their kids to public schools, travel by public transportation, and wear clothing from Goodwill. Dotting the surrounding area are churches, mosques, temples, and synagogues, each serving the unique religious needs of our community. Scattered among these places of worship are dozens of restaurants serving every kind of cultural and ethnic food one can imagine. At the center of it all is Walmart, the placeless place where we all go to find what we need. On the surface, my neighborhood would seem to be fairly diverse and cosmopolitan. We are made up of people of different religions, genders, ages, occupations, food preferences, cultures, income levels, and native languages. And yet, for all our very real differences, my neighbors and I have something in common that transcends those differences and orders nearly every part of our lives. It's obviously not our ethnic heritage, nor our common upbringing. It's not the place we live, nor our hatred of the August heat in Texas. The one thing we all share in common is a lifestyle thoroughly saturated with technology. A completely different world. When people use the word technology, most of the time they mean something like internet-connected gadgets or apps of some kind. Computer scientist Alan Kay, inventor of the mouse, famously picked up on our tendency to think of technology as the latest thing by defining technology as anything that was invented after you were born. He was pointing out how quickly we take for granted technology that once seemed amazing but now feels commonplace. If we broaden our perspective on technology to consider more than just the last several decades, we can see just how rapidly our world has been changing. A century ago, the idea of communicating electronically with anyone at any time would have seemed like magic. By the standards of 1900, the differences between communicating via landline, Zoom, or virtual reality would be meaningless, because a person from that era would not yet be accustomed to hearing disembodied voices from across the globe. Even the most educated and advanced individual of the early 1800s could not see a distinction between the clunky big-screen TVs of the 1980s that took up an entire living room and a modern home theater, because they lived in a time before even photography was commonplace. Almost all the tools we use on a daily basis, light bulbs, cars, washing machines, air conditioning, TVs, phones, the internet, and so on, were invented in the past 150 years. But these tools are so normal to us that it seems strange to call them technology. Technology has changed our world so drastically that the biblical character Abraham of 2000 BC would probably have more in common with Abraham Lincoln of the early 1800s than Lincoln would have with us in the 21st century. The biblical Abraham's father raised cattle, and Mr. Lincoln planted pumpkins. But most of us spend the majority of our time indoors, working at desks, with little knowledge of the natural world. Both men attended small religious gatherings with people they knew well from the surrounding area, while we drive several miles to sit next to people we often don't know, or we join services online with people halfway around the world. They lived in small, one-bedroom dwellings lit by candles. We live in comparatively enormous homes equipped with electricity and internet connections. They wrote letters and spoke in person. We write electronically and speak through devices. They weathered the seasons. We control the weather with air conditioning that contributes to global climate change. We could go on making various comparisons, but the point is that our world is so uniformly technological that even in an ethnically and religiously diverse community like my neighborhood, the day-to-day activities of my neighbors probably have more in common with one another than with the founders of our country. Technology has become a kind of supra-cultural phenomenon that finds its way into every aspect of our diverse lives. Not a single one of these devices or behaviors existed just over a century ago, and yet all of us treat them as if they were as normal as the water we drink or the air we breathe. So why does any of this matter? If more advanced technology leads to things like increased quality of life and faster ways to spread the gospel, what could be the harm in any of it? Why do we need to pay close attention to the influence of technology? The story of a certain young pastor and yet another projector shows what can happen when we ignore technology. The youth pastor and the projector. After I graduated from college, I took a job as a youth pastor at a nearby church. One of my first requests to the church was to buy a video projector for our youth room. As a youth pastor at a Bible church, my job was to make sure the kids were firmly planted in the Scriptures. That meant that they needed to regularly encounter the words of the Bible with their own eyes. The only problem was that many of the kids didn't bring Bibles. I figured that a projector would allow me to put the words of God on screen so everyone could read together, whether they brought a Bible or not. And as a bonus, we could play video games on a gigantic screen and call it ministry. Eventually, a generous church member donated a projector, and I immediately began using it during all my teaching. I made fantastic sermon outlines and highlighted important words in the text. I peppered my teaching with captivating stories and concluded them with hilarious punchlines. I taught verse by verse, but I also made the scriptures relevant and applicable to the kids' lives. They seemed to eat it up, and at the risk of sounding haughty, I think I was a pretty good youth leader. But then, things started to go terribly wrong. I noticed that fewer and fewer kids were bringing their Bibles to church each week, and those who did bring them rarely opened them when I was teaching. Perhaps I was not the model youth pastor I thought myself to be. I tried saying, "Open your Bibles too," more often, but that didn't seem to help. They just ignored me when I said it. I tried toning down my wit and charm and focusing more on the text of Scripture. But no matter how much I emphasized the Bible, the kids still wouldn't bring or open theirs. Finally, I pulled aside one of my students and said, "I talk to y'all all the time about how important the Bible is, but I notice you don't bring your Bible to church anymore. Why don't you think the Bible is important?" She answered, "But I do think the Bible is important. I just like reading it on the screen with everybody else. Why would I bring a Bible if you project it on screen?" This situation opened my eyes to how technologies that surround us can have an impact on something as intimate as how we encounter the Scriptures. I imagined that the projector would level the playing field and give everyone equal access to the Word of God. In my mind, a projector was a perfectly normal thing to bring into a church. All I was doing was taking the unchanging, eternal Word of God and transferring it to a newer, better medium that had the power to reach more students. I never considered that the projector would profoundly transform the way my students encountered God's Word and each other. I didn't fully understand what had happened that day, but years later, when I began to study the effects technology can have on people, I initially felt like I had acted with terrible ignorance. I wondered, how could I have done so much damage to my kids without even knowing it? My technological choices meant that suburban American kids, gasp, weren't bringing their Bibles into church buildings. After all, what's a Bible church without Bibles? However, as I contemplated this, I realized that my perspective was even more myopic than I had first thought. Whereas I initially considered not bringing a Bible to church a tragedy, I soon realized that is a relatively recent phenomenon in church history. Until the printing press made Bibles inexpensive and available to everyone, individuals rarely owned their own copy of the Bible. Every single believer, from Moses to Martin Luther, from 1500 BC to AD 1500, encountered God's Word by going to church and listening to it alongside others. They almost never had the chance to read the Bible for themselves. This meant that for nearly 3,000 years, there was not a single believer in the one true God who ever had a quiet time as we know it today. Only rabbis and priests had access to handwritten copies of the Bible, but common people simply could not afford them. Gutenberg's printing press allowed families to purchase a copy of the Scriptures, but it was not until the 20th century that it became common for individuals to own a personal copy of the Bible. Looking back on what happened in my youth pastor days, I realized the projector had actually allowed my kids to experience God's Word in a way that might be closer to the pre-printing press era. My students had given up their individualized Bible with custom covers and specialized study notes and had begun reading the same words on the same screen together as a community of faith. By transitioning from print to projector, we had moved forward technologically and yet backward culturally. Today, most of us have Bible apps on our phones, shifting the medium and the expectations around it yet again. It's possible that someone who only uses apps might not have a good grasp of how the Bible is laid out, or how much larger the Old Testament is than the New Testament. More significantly, research suggests that people interpret passages differently on a phone than they do in print. It turns out that these kinds of cultural shifts have been well documented by historians of technology. Some even argue that the last 500 years, from the time of the printing press to the time of the smartphone, will be seen as an aberration in human history. These five centuries will have been the only time in human history when printed text was the dominant form of communication. Today, with smartphones, video chat, and VR, we are returning to a culture of spoken words rather than printed text. And yet, those spoken words are not shared with people who are physically nearby. My point here is not to argue that it is better to hear the Bible orally than to read it in print, or that reading on a screen with a group is better than either of those. Instead, it is important to recognize how little attention we pay to the technologies we use to encounter the Word of God. While God's words are eternal and unchanging, when we change the tools we use to access those words, the new medium brings subtle changes to our practices of worship, interpretation, and community. When we fail to recognize the impact of such technological change, we run the risk of allowing our tools to dictate our methods and disciple our people. Technology should not dictate our values or our methods. Rather, we must use technology out of our convictions and values. When I installed the projector, I still mistakenly believed that technology was simply neutral, and all that mattered was how I used it. I thought that as long as I used the projector for good things like showing the Bible and avoided bad things like R-rated movies or some 1980s PG movies, I was operating in a distinctly Christian way. What I didn't realize at the time was that technology is never neutral because it has a shaping power on us and those around us. Whether we use it for good or evil, every technology has a set of values that intersects with our own, and we must learn together to see and discern those values so we can use technology critically and faithfully. The myth of technology. So why is it that we tend not to recognize the changes that technology brings? Why did I have so little awareness of how the printed Bible had shaped my expectation of church and how the projected Bible would reshape it? Neil Postman attempted to explain this by saying that over time, technology tends to become mythic. By myth, Postman wasn't referring to a legend or fantasy story. Instead, he used the word myth to describe the way of life that people think of as normal. In this sense, a myth is the story that develops over time about how the world works and what makes sense to a group of people. For example, most people know that leaders of the United States are chosen by voting. Before July 4, 1776, the idea of voting for leaders was new and radical. But over time, voting has become a part of our shared myth about the way government is supposed to work. When a new technology comes along, it too seems strange, out of place, and even magical. As sci-fi writer Arthur C. Clarke once quipped, "Any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic." Sitting in a coffee shop, the person with a brand new laptop, a little slimmer and lighter than last year's model, stands out. However, as futurist Jamaise Caskio writes, as technologies move from the pages of a science fiction story to the pages of a catalog, something interesting happens. They lose their power to disturb. They're no longer the advanced forces of the tech-pocalypse. They're the latest manifestation of the fashionable, the ubiquitous, and the banal. They're normal. Today, nearly every adult in the United States has a phone. But in the late 1990s, even a cell phone was considered a bit of an extravagance, only for very important business people. Going back in time, the same could be said of portable music players. The first Sony Walkman was released in 1979. Microwaves, 1947. Air conditioning, 1920s, and human flight, 1903. Each technology was a revolution when it first arrived, but now they are all such a part of everyday life that it's difficult to imagine life without them. The longer a particular practice or device has been around, the more solidly mythic it becomes in our culture. Eventually, we stop thinking about why it was there in the first place, and over time, we lose the ability, or desire, to question its presence. Those who might question a common technology, like phones or microwaves, might as well be crazy. It would be like doubting that hot dogs should be eaten at sporting events, or that Texans should have air conditioning. Adding to this, each generation tends to approach technology from a slightly different perspective. Douglas Adams, the author of The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, once grouped technology into three categories. First, echoing Alan Kay, everything that's already in the world when you're born is just normal. Then, anything that gets invented between then and before you turn 30 is incredibly exciting and creative, and with any luck, you can make a career out of it. Finally, anything that gets invented after you're 30 is against the natural order of things and the beginning of the end of civilization as we know it until it's been around for about 10 years when it gradually turns out to be all right, really. In other words, each generation is equipped with a different myth concerning technology. The faster technology develops, and the less perspective we have, the more stratified our myths become. Similarly, different cultural groups tend to negotiate technological change differently, depending on how its values intersect with those of their community. Short-sighted critiques of technology. These generational gaps mean that younger people often uncritically embrace any and all technology, while older generations sometimes make short-sighted critiques of technology. Consider, for example, a New York Times article discussing how preteen children interact online and via text messaging. The author begins by describing how teens chat through various apps late into the night, and her tone suggests that she disapproves of this way of interacting through technology. She then laments, "Children used to actually talk to their friends. Those hours spent on the family princess phone or hanging out with pals in the neighborhood after school vanished long ago." The author obviously wants to contrast the technological communication her children engage in with the embodied face-to-face encounters she remembers from her youth. But did you notice how she paired hanging out with pals in the neighborhood after school with hours spent on the landline phone, as if both were equally non-technological? Chances are the author was born after the telephone was invented and turned 30 sometime before texting or social media. For her, talking on the phone feels natural or even real, while app-based communication does not. But I imagine that if we were to dig deeply into the New York Times archives, we might find a similar article written in the 1950s that would criticize talking for hours on the phone. Just a generation ago, talking on the phone for hours would have seemed as foreign and unhealthy as the texting habits of today's children. If we were to dig even further back in the archives, a pattern would quickly emerge in which the older generation is worried about the technology of the new generation, while they are largely unaware of their own technological heritage. How can we question the next generation's technology if we don't even understand our own? It turns out that the phenomenon of questioning new technology while clinging to older technology is not limited to New York Times authors and youth pastors like myself. It happens at all levels of society and in churches around the world. Uncovering the myth. What this tells us is that the way we talk about and understand technology is, in some ways, dictated by where we sit along the timeline of technological progress. Rather than taking our cues about technology from the scriptures and the outline of God's plan for humanity, we seem to be locked in a cycle of questioning the really, really new, but accepting the just barely old. We question the young for the blind acceptance of the latest gadgets, but we do so driving our computerized cars to and from church, sipping on coffee grown on another continent. Today's technology has the power to heal the sick and make the blind see. Luke chapter 7, verse 22. Yet it also has the power to overwhelm us and distract us from what is truly important. When technology has distracted us to the point that we no longer examine it, it gains the greatest opportunity to enslave us. To avoid this cycle, we'll need to start from the beginning and explore how the scriptures treat technology. In the coming chapters, we will follow the outline of the biblical story, beginning with creation and continuing to the fall and to redemption and finally to restoration. As we discover the role of technology in each chapter of the biblical story, it will lead us to a follow-up question in the following chapter that will help us better understand technology. Chapter 2 will introduce the relationship of stories, faith, and technology, showing how they interact to form our ideas about the world. In Chapter 3, we will delve into the biblical story, starting with the creation, where God gives humanity the role of reflecting His image and charges them with cultivating and keeping the garden. In the following chapter, we will explore the unique role of technology among the things humans create. Then, in Chapter 5, we will look at Adam and Eve's rebellion, the fall, and the subsequent evil use of technology that find their origin in Cain and his family. This will lead us to explore a more fully developed philosophical approach to technology in Chapter 6. In Chapter 7, we will begin exploring the various mediums through which God accomplishes His plan of redemption. And in Chapter 8, we will hear how those mediums operate within a culture and how they shape individuals. In Chapter 9, we will complete the biblical story by looking at what God will do when He restores the earth. Chapter 10 will pick up where the biblical story leaves off, examining how the world of technology has continued to develop into a kind of religion unto itself. Finally, in Chapter 11, we will look at the digital revolution and use what we've learned to help us understand and live faithfully in our current age and with the advances to come. At one end of the story is a pristine garden prepared by God for humankind to develop and transform. At the other end is a glorious, heavenly city full of human creations, art, and technology. At the center is our Savior Jesus Christ, crucified on a cross, the most horrific of all technological distortions, built by transforming a tree from the natural world into a tool of death. Yet in His resurrection, Christ redeemed even that tool, transforming it into the symbol of our faith that eternally portrays His power over death and sin. In the time between the garden and the city, between Christ's first and second coming, when He will complete His work of redemption and restoration, we must work diligently to understand how to live faithfully in this technology-saturated world. To help us better understand our world, we will combine what we find in the Scriptures with insights from some of the best thinkers on technology, theology, and culture. We will largely limit our discussion to everyday kinds of technology, meaning that we won't spend significant time addressing important societal issues like healthcare, nuclear weapons, or biotechnology. But the overall ethics we find in Scripture can apply broadly to all areas of human making. Embracing technology faithfully. It would be convenient if we could simply label every technology as either good, use it as much as you want, or bad, never, ever use it. But Arthur Bors posits that technology is more like the yellow light on a traffic signal. Unlike green, which always means go, or red, which always means stop, the yellow light is a call for a discerning look at the entire situation. Technology is a God-given good part of what it means to be human. But first, we need to recognize that, like all of creation, it was warped by the fall. And second, we must learn to detect how it shapes us even as we use it. A surprisingly helpful example of this kind of technological discernment can be found in an obscure passage in one of John's letters. In 2 John, chapter 1, verse 12, the apostle wrote, "I have much to write to you, but I do not want to use paper and ink. Instead, I hope to visit you and talk with you face to face, so that our joy may be complete." For John and the early church, pen and ink was the primary communication technology they had to choose from and evaluate. Though writing might seem low-tech to us today, the philosophers of that day were considering how it was influencing learning and community. A few hundred years before John wrote his letters, the Greek philosopher Socrates expressed concern about the technology of writing. He believed that learning through dialogue was the key to helping people grow in wisdom, and he worried that writing would make people knowledgeable, but it would fail to make them wise. Socrates was so worried about the damage that writing could cause that he never wrote any of his own ideas down. In his letters, John gives us a model of how to consider the advantages and disadvantages of a particular technology. Notice that he says there are some things he would rather not write and would prefer to reserve for when he could come to them face to face. We could read this as John saying face to face is always better than technologically mediated communication. But John isn't being critical of writing or saying that he was using it only as a last resort. Rather, he is telling us that both are valuable for the health of the church. We just need to have the discernment to know when to use which form. After all, if the apostles didn't embrace the technology of writing, we wouldn't have the New Testament, and John wouldn't have been able to brag about being a faster runner than Peter in John chapter 20, verse 4. And yet, he also recognizes that certain things are best handled in person. In the internet era, we sometimes talk about online and offline as two entirely different things, where one is real and the other is less than real. But researchers like Heidi Campbell have shown that we move fluidly between online and offline contexts several times throughout the day, using online communication to plan and enrich our offline encounters. Our goal, then, is not to say which technology is superior, but to develop the discernment to know which form is best for which activity, which medium for which message. The Apostle Paul, for example, often expressed a deep longing to see his faraway friends, Romans chapter 1, verse 11. But in other cases, he felt writing a letter would be more redemptive, 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 14 through 21, 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verses 8 through 9. If we take the time to understand how each communication technology works and what it values, we can use them alongside our face-to-face conversation in a way that, as John says, makes our joy complete. The apostles appear to have been aware of the strengths and weaknesses of the new technology of writing, and they made calculated choices about when to use it in service of the embodied life of the church and for the flourishing of their city. In doing so, they honored our Lord and built up his body. My hope is that in the coming chapters, we can learn to do the same with today's technology. Questions. How do you tend to think of technology? Is it primarily good, bad, or neutral? What is a technology that has come along in your lifetime that has had a major impact on your world and the world around you? What are some technologies that you use regularly, but rarely think about? That is, have become unquestioned or mythic? 2. Imagination. When I was in first grade, one of my parents' friends from Mississippi gave us a huge wooden fort. The fort was over 20 feet tall, with a ladder reaching up into the main platform and a pole sliding back down for quick escapes. For my siblings and me, the fort was the perfect opportunity for our young imaginations to run wild. That fort transformed us into pirates at sea, doctors saving patients, and knights storming the castle. It's commonly held that adults have lost the propensity for the imaginative play that my siblings and I took for granted. Kids, we are told, have the ability to look past the world as it is and see the world as it could be. But adults are only able to see the real world. Yet when it comes to using technology, the ability to imagine and tell stories is constantly being awakened, even in adults. In fact, whenever we use a tool, whether it be a shovel or a phone, three powerful stories unfold: how we shape the world with technology, how technology shapes us, and how we see the world through technology. Exploring these three stories in this chapter will help us begin to uncover the place of technology in our lives and in the story God is telling.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.